Okay, ClubWWI.com members, I'm standing by with someone who, well, chances are you just saw him on WWE TV, and now, well, he's out of WWE, and he's here at ClubWWI.com. He's somebody who, in his career, has probably done a lot more than a lot of wrestlers ever get a chance to do. Now he's here to talk about it all. Folks, the one and only, Mr. Shawn Daivari. Shawn, how are you?
Good, how are you, James?
Good, I'm glad to have you on the show. How's everything going by you?
Everything's fine, man. Anytime you need me, I'm here.
Awesome. Well, I mean, before anything, I guess the first question that everybody has on their mind, gone from WWE, and it sounds like it's not the kind of thing where, you know, you weren't fired for anything. You had a unique story, so why don't you let everybody know what's going on and what led to you leaving the company?
Yeah, pretty much was we were in the midst of a contract renegotiation, and there was a couple things that I wanted to do, and WWE agreed with it as far as, like, the contract stuff, which is really only, like, legalities and black and white stuff. But there's a few things I was looking to do on the creative end that you really can't put into contract. You just have to take their word for it and see that if it's going to get done. And then kind of all the writing on the wall for me from the different people I've talked to, from, you know, bottom, from the writer that just started that week, all the way up top to Vince McMahon and Stephanie McMahon I spoke with right before I asked for my release, was they had nothing majorly planned for me at the moment. Didn't mean something wasn't going to come up. Didn't mean something wouldn't come up, you know. I don't know. But at that point in time, I kind of felt like maybe it would be better if I seek my fortunes elsewhere. And I even asked them, you know, separately in conversations with talent relations and with Vince and Stephanie, if they would be offended or upset at all if I didn't re-sign the contract they offered me and actually bowed out of the current contract I was in a little earlier. And they were actually very cool that obliged to that. If they really wanted to be jerks, they could have benched me for the rest of the term of my contract, but they were nice enough to, you know, make a mutual dissolvement of my contract. So now, kind of left in good terms, and now I'm ready for the next chapter of my career.
That's really awesome. I think there's so many times when people leave the company, and it always ends up becoming sometimes this big kind of battle back and forth, and, you know, for lack of a better term, almost a pissing contest between people. But people who leave kind of on the terms that you leave on, I mean, they get a chance to one day return to the company after having their own opportunity to make their own character.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, WWE is a business more than anything. You know, even people that left on bad terms, like, we just saw last year Bret Hart do something with the company. It's, you know, there's never a yes or no answer, a definite burn bridge. But I'm also, you know, I'd like to stay professional as much as possible, and I was very glad that we got to do that with all parties, from the McMahon, talent relations, to creative. We kind of made just like a mutual divorce, so there wasn't any bickering or bitching back and forth or complaints that one party did not hold up their end of the agreement or the other didn't or did. So it was a real cool deal for me that we just got to kind of make it a nice, very professional mutual divorce, and then hopefully, if, who knows, down the road some point in time, it's necessary for me to go back to WWE or WWE feels necessary to have me back, you know, that opportunity or option is always on the table.
That's really cool. Well, I mean, your career has really been something that's a lot of people have watched and were surprised at kind of how things turned out, because originally when you first came in to the main roster with WWE, you were involved in a character and an angle that ended up creating a storm of controversy that was beyond, I guess, what anybody expected. You were part of, you and Muhammad Hassan were the duo that came into Raw and got a lot of the controversy. Were you surprised when you guys first debuted that it got the reaction that, I mean, obviously it was there to be a hot button, but it kind of took hot buttons to a whole new level?
Yeah, it was something really hot, but it was also, you know, I think it became that way because, you know, all parties involved, myself, Muhammad, and WWE, let it become such a big deal. And it's not to say that it's something that still can't be a big deal today. Mm-hmm. That was, you know, that's something I kind of battle with myself every single day, where it's like, you know, in my career, at one point in time, I was, you know, part of the main events of several pay-per-views with huge names, from John Cena to The Undertaker to Hulk Hogan to Shawn Michaels, and today it seems like, you know, right before I left WWE, I'd taken a few steps backwards, and that wasn't something that I was prepared or ready to do. So, yeah, as far as what we accomplished or the amount of heat that we got thrown on us, it was astronomical, and part of me still feels that it still can be a big deal today. It never really fully ran its course, unfortunately, due to circumstances outside of my control. We had to kill it a little earlier than I had hoped. So, you know, that might ultimately have led to down the road why I decided it was time for me to leave today, because I still think I do have a whole lot to offer in, you know, somewhat of a high on the card or main event capacity to the wrestling industry.
Mm-hmm. Well, you, I mean, obviously, I mean, working with Muhammad Hassan, he's the kind of guy that, a lot of different stories from different people about him backstage, and I know there's always been stories about him having heat with this one and that one. I mean, was that your experience with him, or was it pleasant for you? What was it like just working with, I guess, Mark backstage?
Me and him always got along. Still to this day, we talk at least, you know, every week or every other week, and, you know, we're really good friends. We've always been able to get along from day one. Some people didn't take well to his personality, and some did, but it was never anything I thought he did out of ill intent, or there was nothing he ever did to deserve any of the flack he got from people. But also, from what I've heard, other people have asked me as fans and stuff about when this happened and that happened. Some of the stories were so blown out of proportion that I don't know where they got their news from, the internet or whatever, when they asked about, oh, I heard he did this, and everybody did that to him, was like completely blown out of proportion. You know, it wasn't any more of a tiff than any other person had, just apparently he was in a high profile at the time, so it made for juicy, you know, internet news or internet rumors.
Yeah, a lot of times it kind of seems like, we've talked to people who've been in similar positions, when you come in and you have such a hot character, a lot of times there's natural jealousy from a lot of people who might have been there already that wanted to kind of maybe over-exaggerate things.
Yeah, it's totally possible. You know, the stuff that I've seen him go through, I've seen, you know, guys that kind of stay on the bottom of the card go through too, but obviously that's not going to make for entertaining news, so some of that stuff never gets reported. But it was never to the point where it was just this big whole ordeal where it was kind of like the locker room had to take a step back and assess the situation and correct it. It was never anything huge like that.
Yeah. Well, you guys had a chance. I mean, you talked about it before, but, I mean, being part of that angle, I mean, you had a chance to work with, I guess the biggest one would be Hulk Hogan at that WrestleMania where you guys came out. And for somebody, I mean, you're a lot like me growing up watching the business. What was that like? I mean, really getting a chance at this point in your career and in this time frame, for a lot of people kind of assuming maybe Hogan wouldn't even be an active person in the business at all now, not only getting to be there, but be at WrestleMania and working with somebody like that.
That was like still, I say all the time, that was the highlight of my career. That was something that it really doesn't get that big for anybody, let alone two guys that were just brand new and just getting started. You know, you have arguably one of the biggest names in the entire industry. You get to work with him. On top of that, you get to work with him in his comeback swan song. On top of that, you get to work with him at WrestleMania. It's like, there's, you know, you wish to do one of those three things, and we did all three things in one night. That's something that, you know, if maybe that happened at the end of my career, I might still be there today. But for that to happen at the start of my career, it just made me feel like there's so much more for me to do and so much more I have to offer that, you know, doing what I was doing the last few days, last few months, I should say, really felt like a step backwards from where I once was.
Absolutely. Well, I mean, it kind of seems like, I mean, you guys definitely came in on a high note, and it seemed like when it was pulled off TV, you guys were just getting to that point where it was going to explode. I know a lot of people still remember the angle with The Undertaker, and it was kind of had the undertones to it, and I guess it was the timing of the whole thing happening the day of the London bombings when it actually aired. I mean, did you know when you found out that they were going to air it that day, did you say to yourself, you know, this could be a bad thing?
No, actually, you know, usually when we only get a couple days off a week, we just kind of lay low and stay home and sleep. And I actually had no idea that even happened. I don't know if I was out and about. I believe SmackDown was on Thursdays at that point in time. And I had no idea that morning, or maybe it was the day before or something, that stuff happened. I had no idea it happened. So I was watching SmackDown, and I saw that little ticker on the bottom. And I believe, in my heart, at that point in time, you know, I'm not trying to defend them. I don't know for sure. I don't know. But I believe at that point in time, it's already handed into UPN. So I don't know if they have the ability to do editing other than just completely cutting it out. And it was about a 20-minute segment. So I don't know what they could have done if they just could have put 20 minutes of you know, color bars, or they could have just, you know, had the audience shots for 20 minutes. At that point in time, I really don't know what options they had available. But again, as a television show, which is the bottom line, what we are is a television show, I don't think that if there was a bombing on Sopranos that night on HBO, anybody would have said anything.
Oh, exactly. Well, I mean, I think, you know, that's one of the things that we've always kind of debated on here, trying to figure out exactly what it was about the angle that really got people going. I mean, a lot of a lot of times you hear from people that, you know, sometimes because it's wrestling and the rest of the show sometimes has comical stuff here and other stuff here. It's such a variety show that sometimes people tend to put a lot more on it than they really should, and it doesn't really get the leeway that some of those other shows do get.
Oh, yeah, of course. And another thing, too, is you can't forget that the pressure the media puts on people of power to make decisions like that. Like, I remember Bradshaw did something goofy, some sort of Nazi salute in Germany that was part of a freaking wrestling show, of all things. Like, it had nothing to do with legitimate connotations. And I believe he had a TV show on some network, and the bigwigs over there felt that that was such a big deal, that was so offensive because maybe one person emailed them about it, that they canned his show. And the same thing with Don Imus. You know, I don't remember exactly what it was he did, but apparently he made one rude comment that wasn't probably anything worse than you'd hear on Howard Stern or Man Cow or Bubba the Love Sponge, but it just takes that one person to email someone or call someone on top of the food chain, and then they're forced to react. Maybe it's a good decision, maybe it's a bad decision, but if they don't do something positively or negatively, it makes it seem like they don't do anything. And sometimes it just takes that one person or one phone call or one little thing to ruin something astronomically for a person, which is what I felt happened with us, because I really don't think there was any sort of wrestling fan or anyone anywhere that thought what we did was so, so offensive that it was worth destroying, you know, a huge career in the making over.
Yeah, it's funny with political correctness, because I mean, I still remember being a kid watching the AWA, and they had this one match where Colonel De Beers wanted to paint a black wrestler white, and I don't think I ever heard about that anywhere outside of ESPN, but nowadays you can't really, you can't sneeze the wrong way without getting a few letters sent.
Yeah.
Well, let me ask you this, because one of the things that always intrigues people is kind of things that were supposed to be and never actually happened. Now, obviously, you guys were ramping up right around the time everything happened with The Undertaker and you got pulled off of UPN. What was the original plan? Where was that supposed to go had that been allowed to play out?
You know, I really don't know, because they really don't tell us things actually, nothing really is in concrete, but they really don't tell us too much until it's like a for sure thing going to happen. Mm-hmm. And I never heard this from any office person or saw it promoted anywhere, but my understanding was at that point in time, Muhammad was supposed to work Batista at Summerslam.
Okay.
Because I believe the story going into that was, you know, obviously it's Washington, D.C., United States Capitol, and it's Batista's hometown, so they were going to kind of promote it and make a big deal out of it, but no one from WWE Creative ever told me that was going to happen, and I never saw it on paper, and I never saw a promotion for it, which usually we promote pay-per-views about 3 months out.
Mm-hmm.
So the fact that I never saw a commercial or never saw a poster for it doesn't mean that it was a dumb decision. It might have just been an idea on the table.
Yeah, a lot of times it kind of comes out like that. But what was cool was after this, I mean, obviously, and I've read this about you online, and correct me if I'm wrong, but you grew up, and one of the guys that you grew up really watching in the business was Shawn Michaels. Is that right?
Yeah. Well, that's actually where I stole my name.
Oh, yeah?
So first name is Dara Daivari, but when I started wrestling, Dara is an Iranian name, pretty common name amongst men, but, you know, in the United States, anything that ends with an A is kind of feminine. So the guy I started training with was going to advertise me on a poster for, like, an independent show. And I was like, what the hell kind of name is Dara? We can't call you that. And then, you know, he actually had a pretty good hand in getting Sean Waltman's career started. And his exact quote, which turned out he said to everybody, but I thought he actually saw something special in me, was, we got the next Sean Waltman on our hands, we're going to call him Dara. And then that's where we got Sean from. And then I changed the spelling to the S-H-A-W-N after Shawn Michaels.
That's really cool. I mean, is this kind of thing that Shawn never found out? Like, did you tell him when you eventually ended up working with him? Like, hey, you know.
I might have, because on all the paperwork, like whenever we had travel itineraries or stuff, any sort of legal documents, it always had my real name. And maybe he had asked me. I don't remember, but I've had so many intricate stories about so many different talents at so many different points in time that, you know, I'm sure told all of them about it at one point or another. Like, I remember one time I snuck backstage at a Target Center show in Minneapolis, and Triple H had me thrown out. I remember, like, I told him that, and a bunch of weird, like, stories I've had run-in with people. Like, I remember one time I did an independent show with Ken Kennedy, and Ted DiBiase was my manager, and a few months later he came in and, you know, was an agent for us for a while, and I told him, like, hey, do you remember that one time I wrestled, you know, Ken Kennedy on one of your shows, and then you were my manager, and he had no idea that we ever did that. So, like, I always have these, like, run-ins with people that were kind of, like, big milestone moments in my career, and they had no idea that it ever happened.
That's true. I mean, but it must be cool, I mean, for you, at least growing up as a fan, as we've talked to wrestlers on here, and it's such a different experience for people who were fans and got into the business, and those who kind of, you know, got into it either because, you know, they were playing football and they stopped, or they just, you know, kind of got introduced to it. I mean, for people like, I guess you and I, who grew up watching it, it just changes the whole thing once you get involved and start meeting these people.
Yeah, no, it definitely does. And, you know, like I said, there's tons of stories like that I can't even remember that are, like, you know, everyday occurrences now, and then, like, I might be hanging out with someone for a long time, and then all of a sudden I remember, like, oh, yeah, I remember one time when I was 7 years old, I did this, or I remember one time I went to see Ric Flair for an autograph signing, and he wouldn't take a picture with me or something. Like, there's tons of things that you just forget about happen, and then once they become, like, your everyday friends, or, you know, sometimes closer than your friends because you're just with them all the time, you know, stuff like that just kind of goes out of the back of your head, and you remember the new life you have with them.
Oh, totally. Well, I brought up Shawn Michaels because you got a chance when you came back after the whole Hassan thing. You got to be Kurt Angle's personal referee on SmackDown. You guys got to work at a storyline almost with Shawn Michaels where, you know, you guys were involved and Angle was feuding with him. To get a chance to do that, somebody that you respected to that amount, and then now get a chance to not only work with him, but somebody like Kurt Angle, who at that time was probably the top of, you know, of the business altogether. I mean, that was definitely a high point for you there.
Oh, yeah, definitely. And a lot of the good stuff that, you know, people only see, you know, the career that happens on television. There was, I think, about, you know, a good couple months straight where we're working with Shawn every single night. And, you know, sometimes I'd even, you know, be in, like, tag matches or mixed tags. I think sometimes we did, like, me and Hassan against Jericho and Shawn Michaels or something. Like, we worked a lot, and, like, there was nothing worse than being in there with him and letting him down, which I think I did like once or twice, and that's like the ultimate feeling, like of ultimate dog shit in the world, where it's like, this is someone you idolize and look up to, and you know, I didn't perform up to his level, or I could have done so much more for him, and I didn't. There was nothing worse than feeling than that in the world, but when things went right, you know, then on the flip side of that, it was great. It was just like to get the approval or praise of someone you've looked up to for so long, and have them be like, wow, that was a really good job you did. Or sometimes, like, you know, we were doing tag matches at the time with Rhino and Tajiri, and then to come back after the thing and see Shawn sat at the monitor and watched the whole thing and praised you on your work and said, you know, wow, that was really good. That was really impressive. You know, you're really catching on. Like, stuff like that, there's no better feeling in the world.
See, that's awesome. That kind of, in a way, it almost sounds like I know a lot of people have talked about since you left WWE, but it sounds like, I mean, your goal now is to kind of improve your own career, and it sounds like you're always trying to improve on what you're doing.
Yeah, no, that's exactly it. You know, and that's actually something else that he told me. He said that his career every year has gotten better than the one before. And that's something that in 2007, I didn't see that happen for me. And that's why I felt maybe now is the time for me to move on to make sure 2008 that does happen. Because from when I started in the year 2000 till today, 2007, every year I have to move forward, I feel. My professional career has advanced a little bit. And it seemed like 07, I was kind of in a stalemate. So now I'm going to try something new, try something better to make sure 2008, 2009, 2010 continue moving forward.
That's really cool. Well, one of the other cool things about your career is that you haven't just been limited to wrestling. One of the big things that WWE seem to love to do is have you serve as a manager. Not only Muhammad Hassan, but also, you know, Mark Henry and Great Khali. For you, getting to manage, I mean, is that something you enjoyed? Was it something that you rather, you know, wish you were in the ring instead? Or was it something that, you know, you kind of was open to?
Well, no, I was open to it, and it served like two purposes. I could tell you why. Is one was obviously my passion has always been wrestling. That's what I really, really love to do. But on a professional point of view, to be a manager in those certain scenarios were very, very big deals to me because, you know, like, let's take example Kurt Angle. Kurt Angle at the time was supposed to be the company's top heel, and people still liked him. They still cheered him, and he really couldn't get that much heat because the people liked him. And then, you know, for the management to think that this kid has got so much heat and people hate him so much, we need to put him with our main event guy to keep that guy heel. That's a huge compliment coming from management. And then same thing with Mark Henry. Mark Henry started on SmackDown, and they really wanted him to be the top heel on SmackDown at that point in time, and they were just thinking, how can we get this guy, like, you know, from I believe he just made a comeback, he just started, I think before he got injured or before he left, he was a babyface, and I think they were just saying, how are we going to get this guy with a lot of heat and enough heat to get into a main event position right away, let's put Daivari with them. You know, that's another huge compliment. Same thing with Khali. Khali started his first day, and they said, we need this guy in main eventer by next week. What can we do? You know, put Daivari with him, put as much heat on him as possible. That's, you know, although personally, I would like being in the ring more so, but professionally, that's just a huge, huge compliment from management to do that, to have that kind of confidence in me that I can get these guys as much heat as they need really quick so they can get ready for the main event. You know, there's no bigger compliment than that, really.
Yeah, I mean, you had a chance. I mean, the guys that you managed, it wasn't really like slower guys, as you said. These are main event guys that were, you know, headlining SmackDown. And I think the big one, I mean, the great Khali, and I've talked to so many people who have met him and been with him. I mean, he's one of these guys that I think fans don't really realize until they're, you know, in person in the arena. They see how huge this guy is. I mean, for you, just standing next to somebody like that, somebody whose legs probably went up to your head, I mean, how insane is it to be there live next to somebody like that?
No, it was cool. You know, me and him actually became very good friends by working together. You know, when he started with WWE, he pretty much, you know, moved to the United States full time. So he was like in a whole new world. You know, had no friends, had no idea what was going on around him. And you know, he started from ground zero with me. You know, he didn't know anybody, didn't trust anybody. He didn't even know how the hell the United States worked. And from that, we became really, really close friends. You know, even just traveling together and sometimes driving together and stuff down the road, we would not only talk about wrestling and discuss wrestling and what we can do to help his career, you know, flourish into this big main event deal, but at the same time, I was teaching him about life. I was teaching him about, you know, how to get a cell phone set up, you know, how to do your laundry, you know, I was trying to teach him how to read a little bit. These were things that, you know, this was bonding that, you know, two professional people can't have. That's something that we're going to be close friends probably for the rest of our lives, because, you know, I really feel like I didn't physically bring him to the United States, but I prepared him for it. So that was something that, you know, I haven't had that type of experience with anybody professionally.
Well, that's awesome. I mean, relationships like that are the kind that, I mean, kind of just play out throughout your entire career. Like, I mean, this is somebody, obviously, just from what he's doing in WWE, it looks like even if the day ever comes that he leaves the company, it sounds like, you know, he's going to be around for a while.
Oh, yeah, definitely. I mean, this business is just kind of like toy box. You probably can hang around as long as you want. There's some facet that a guy like him will always be in demand or always be necessary. And even outside the business, he's already done a couple movies, and he's got a big movie coming out this summer called Get Smart with The Rock and Steve Carell. And, like, the guy's potential is endless, just because to find a guy like him is so rare, and then to find a guy that's like him, looks like him, and has the personality he does is... You know, you could say one in a million, but I think he's the only one in the world.
Oh, totally. Well, while we're still on SmackDown, one of the things, too, that I think a lot of people were surprised by was earlier this year, you actually, they had you in a match where you defeated the Cruiserweight champion. It was a non-title match
right.
Against Greg Helms. Were you surprised because you never ended up winning the Cruiserweight title? At least I don't think you did. I mean, were you surprised that it never actually played out more than that and it ended up just being one non-title win?
Yeah, I think at that point in time, it was kind of like in a transition where Hurricane was a heel, or Hurricane Gregory was a heel champion, and then I was coming in as a new heel, and I think somewhere in there the process was to end up turning Hurricane babyface, and I think once that plan kind of fell apart, then the whole thing was just kind of scrapped and thrown away. Because I remember we were supposed to, we had like a non-title match that week, and then the next week there's supposed to be some other match, and then the third week was the pay-per-view where we were supposed to have a one-on-one title bout. And then somewhere in that second week, something changed or something fell apart where they decided they were no longer going to go that direction with Gregory Helms being a babyface, and I think that whole scenario was crap.
Yeah, it's hard to, like, play. Sometimes things change on the fly so much. That's why we were talking earlier about Hassan and Batista. I mean, so often fans, especially on the Internet, think that they know things, you know, so far in advance. But, I mean, with WWE, sometimes it could take 1 or 2 weeks and just everything changes and you don't even realize.
Yeah, and you never know what the scenario might be. Something like... One little, they call it like a butterfly effect, like one little thing can happen somewhere within the company and it can change the whole structure for the next 6 months.
No, absolutely. Well, after this, one of the things, and I don't know if you took it as a sign, but one of the things that a lot of times fans take as a sign of things changing a bit was when you went over to Raw in kind of that supplemental draft, and Raw doesn't really have a cruiserweight division. So it was kind of like, I mean, you were wrestling, you were heading over to Raw. Did you have a feeling when that happened, when all of a sudden you were heading over to the Raw brand again? Did you have a feeling that it might be getting to the point where your career was starting to wind down with that company?
Well, actually, at that point, it was kind of a jump start. That was something that I actually had wanted to do. Like I said, we'd been in a contract negotiations for a while. One of the things I wanted to do was start working more events on SmackDown. You have to share all the events with ECW. So now, you know, on Raw, you have to fill approximately 8 or 9 matches on a house show or an international tour, 8 or 9 matches on a live event, and you get about 20 guys to pick from. On the SmackDown ECW shows, you got to fill those same 8 or 9 matches, but now you got about 40 guys to pick from.
Okay.
So sometimes it really limits, you know, sometimes you work 1 week on, 1 week off, 2 weeks on, 1 week off, 3 weeks off, you know, 1 week on. You just kind of filtered in and out. If you're on this international tour, you're probably left off the next one. If you're not on that one, you might be going on this one. Stuff like that. One thing I told Talent Relations was that I wanted to work more shows. I didn't feel like I was working as many shows as I'd like to. And that was one of the reasons I think they moved me to Raw. So that way I was kind of in a more solid roster of regular guys. And then from when I went to Raw, immediately I was on all the house shows, went to Africa, went to Mexico, all the overseas tours. I was booked, you know, solidly the whole time I was there. And another thing, too, was I think the way I work or my style of wrestling isn't really limited just to the cruiserweight stuff. You know, I think they felt confident enough that, hang on 1 second.
Yeah, no problem.
I'm just trying to think how I can word this without offending anybody. But, you know, I think they felt that there was more depth to me as a character, that I could do more. Not to say that there isn't any depth to any of the cruiserweight talents, because obviously those are a bunch of great guys itself, but I think those are more expected to be the athletic, you know, athletic bouts, you know, the longer bouts with a lot more exciting action than, say, you know, when I go out there, usually if I have a match, that usually means I got 1 minute of ballyhoo in the front end and probably a 2 minute promo in there, and then whatever's left would be my match.
Mm-hmm. Well, I know exactly what you mean. I mean, I mean, you have to over-explain, because I think that a lot of fans saw that when you went over to Raw, which I was going to say was, it was surprising because a lot of people would assume that it would kind of be a step down, but I feel like I had seen you wrestle more in the last few months than I had seen you wrestle, you know, when you were, you know, managing and things like that. You had gotten to do, you know, different things on Raw, not just wrestling. I mean, obviously you wrestled Cody Rhodes in one of his first matches, which had to be a cool thing too. You got a chance to go out there and work with him right after he first came out.
Yeah, I mean, working with Cody, that was another one of those things where it's, you know, the fans only see what we do on TV, but you know, counting all the house shows and live events and even the dark matches leading up to it, you know, that was another compliment from the office where they had this guy they were getting ready to pull out of OVW, and they were like, we need this guy ready for TV relatively quick, and then he was kind of almost assigned to me like a little project where before he even had his first match with Randy Orton, I think we had, you know, half a dozen to a dozen matches on the house shows and on the and dark matches and stuff, getting them ready from, you know, learning the little transition to go from the developmental system to, you know, the full-time roster.
Mm-hmm.
That was something else that, you know, hearing stuff like that is almost, you know, a pretty big compliment to say they have that much confidence in your ability that you can help out a guy like that.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's not only that, too. I mean, not only being on there wrestling, but also you got to participate in some almost like humorous angles. There was, of course, a lot of people still bring it up when you and Jillian sang Summer Lovin'. I guess you sang it in Farsi. Was that right?
Yeah, I love that kind of stuff. That's the kind of entertainment that I said, you know, not saying that the cruiserweights can't do that, but if there's a certain amount of a lot of time for a cruiserweight match, you can assume that 95% of it is going to be that match.
Mm-hmm.
Something that, you know, because they don't have that specific cruiserweight title or cruiserweight division on Raw, you know, you're really not handcuffed into putting all that time just in the match. You can do a lot of entertainment and ballyhoo and stuff on the front end or the tail end, and you can still have your match in the middle, but for me personally, for my character and for what I bring to the table, I think I can offer the company much, much more as, you know, that sports entertainer than I could just as that straight talent.
No, absolutely. Well, I mean, one of the last things I wanted to ask you, too, obviously now you're at a WWE, and the questions that everybody is going to have is about your next step in your career. So before we get to the one that's probably on everyone's mind, let me ask you this one first. Japan, have you given any thought to perhaps going over to Japan and working with some of those guys?
Yeah, I've actually been in talks with a few promoters from over there. It seems like there's interest in them bringing me in, and there's just as much interest on me going over there. You know, Japan is someplace I've always wanted to work. I wrestled Japan a ton of times, but that was with the WWE and the WWE roster. I was actually supposed to go to Japan to wrestle for 01, I believe, the week before I got signed, and then it was kind of one of those last-second deals where I got offered my contract, and I had to back out. So that was something I've always wanted to do, and I haven't been able to do, is to go over there and work for a Japanese promotion.
Yeah, it sounds like so many guys get a chance to do that. It's cool because they get to go over there, and it's more about, you know, them presenting their own character than I guess, you know, a lot of times companies kind of giving them a character to work with.
Yeah, true, and also learning that style as well. You know, when we go over there with WWE, we put on WWE-style matches. You know, to go over there with a new promotion, you know, like I said, I've learned so much from just being in the WWE about how WWE does things. I couldn't wait to go over there for a Japanese promotion and learn how Japanese people do things. And then, you know, I'm excited to go to Mexico and work with some, like I said, I've worked in Mexico before, but I've been with WWE and we do the WWE-style matches. I can't wait to go for a Mexican promotion and learn the Lucha Libre style. I can't wait to go to Puerto Rico and learn that little more kind of brawling Street Fighter Puerto Rican style wrestling. You know, these are all things that I want to work and have in my memory bank. So, you know, I'd like to be a well-rounded wrestler like an Eddie Guerrero, like a Chris Benoit that they had, you know, Chris Jericho. They've been all over the world, you know, Lance Storm. These are guys that can go anywhere at any point in time and fit right in. There's no more learning curve for them. If Chris Jericho wanted to hop on a plane and go to Japan tomorrow, he'd have it down. If he wanted to go to Mexico, he'd have it down. I still got some learning to do. I still have to learn, you know, the Japanese style. I still have to learn the Mexican style. But I'm hoping, you know, pretty soon in my career, I'll have everything down. I'm just kind of a cog you can plug into any machine.
That's awesome. Well, of course, the one thing that everybody is wondering, TNA, any potential of seeing Daivari popping up and maybe doing an X Division thing or maybe just showing up in the company at all?
Yeah, who knows? Like, you know, I watch your show every week. I think it's a great product. I think they made excellent strides from the day they started till today. And if that's a place that ends up being, you know, a potential option for me to be able to entertain the fans and to contribute something to the company, then I'd definitely like to go. You know, it's not, the top of my resume doesn't say TNA wrestler, WWE wrestler, New Japan wrestler. It just says professional wrestler. And wherever I can contribute and make a difference in the company and make it a better product for their audience is where I'd like to work.
That's cool. All right, Sean, we ask this of all of our guests. Final question we always ask. If you could choose anybody, maybe somebody that you grew up watching, somebody before you got into the business, maybe somebody you never crossed paths with, that you always said to yourself, I wish I could have worked with this person, who would you pick and why?
Oh, man, that's tough.
That's what everybody says.
Two names that come to mind would be Mick Foley, because Mick is always able, I've felt and I think I've seen, he's always able to draw that little extra something out of many of people. I've seen it so many times, like, you know, he'll have a whole bunch of matches with a whole bunch of people, some are memorable, some aren't, but when he does have that memorable match and he pulls that little extra something out of someone, it's unbelievable, and it, you know, it burns an image in your head forever. Like, you know, I can specifically remember moments like the match he had with Randy Orton, where that was a specific match where he pulled a little extra something out of Randy Orton, and at that point in time, that was the best performance we had ever seen out of him. Same thing with Triple H, when Triple H was just getting started in like 99, I believe, in that era, they had a match at a Royal Rumble where I think he pulled a little extra something out of Triple H, and then at that point in time in his career, that was something that, you know, me watching as a fan, I still remember the matches. And it goes on and on with so many different people. You know, he's super good at pulling that little extra something out of somebody. Edge is another one, that match he had with Edge. At that point in time, I thought that was one of Edge's greatest matches I'd ever seen. And the other one would obviously be Shawn Michaels. Now, I know people would say I've wrestled him before, but, you know, there's a difference between a house show match, a TV match, a pay-per-view match, and a WrestleMania match. Mm. If, you know, we've done the house show match, and we've done the TV matches, but those are just, you know, everyday things for Shawn. When Shawn puts on his pay-per-view boots, or even, you know, more especially his WrestleMania boots, what he does, there's nobody in the world that can touch him. And that's something that, you know, I'd like to get one of those matches with him, a pay-per-view match, or even better yet, a WrestleMania match, because when he comes to those, he puts everything out on the table, and I've yet to see him under-deliver. Even deliver to expectations, he always delivers beyond expectations every single time.
You might still get your chance. I mean, he's one of those guys that it seems like the older he gets, he doesn't really seem to lose any steps.
No, he doesn't, and that's something, like, you know, like he told me that makes me think about my career. Every single year since he started, he has reinvented himself and moved on forward. You never see him spinning his wheels for a couple of years. He's always improved himself. And one of those examples is this year. I couldn't believe the match him and John Cena had. And John Cena will be the first to tell you, he's a good friend of mine, that he's not, you know, one of the greatest wrestlers in the world. He's probably one of the best entertainers in the whole company. But as far as actual wrestling ability, he's not the best in the world. But that night at WrestleMania, that match him and Shawn had, he was a phenomenal wrestler. He was amazing. Everything he did was off the hook.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, to say that having that WrestleMania match with Shawn Michaels is something special, I know that he would be able to pull the absolute best performance out of me as well.
Totally. Well, Shawn, before I let you go, we give everybody a chance to speak directly to their fans. And so what do you have to say to all the, I guess, the little Daivaris who have been following you since day one and are looking to see what's next for you?
Yeah, I'm just saying, you know, I'm not going anywhere. I will still be extremely involved in the business of professional wrestling. I'll be around. You can find me, I don't know where or when, but I'll be around. If you look for me, I'm sure you can find me somewhere. And also, if you're looking at see where I'm specifically going to be or if there's someone that specifically wants me on their show, then get a hold of my agent at bookdaivari@hotmail.com, or you can check out www.shawndaivari.com just to learn a little bit more about me or see where I'm going to be performing next.
Awesome. All right, Shawn, thanks again, man, for taking the time to talk to us.
Okay, no problem, James. Thank you.